Eventually, I was in bed by 10 and up by 5 and thus was ready for one more day of my 14th year. Unless grandmother had forgotten the 15 centavos for the bakery down Progreso Street and how I enjoyed jingling those coins in my pocket.
The bread of salt. How did it get that name? From where did its flavor come? Through what secret action of flour and yeast? At the risk of being jostled from the counter by early buyers, I would push my way into the shop so that I will buy a pan de sal, the half light of the street, and hurrying, the paper bag pressed to my chest. I felt my curiosity a little gratified by the oven-fresh warmth of the bread I was proudly bringing home for breakfast. Well, I knew how grandmother would not mind if I nibbled away at one piece. Perhaps I might even eat two, to be charged later against my share at the table. But that would be betraying a trust. And so, indeed, I kept my purchase intact. For my reward, I had only to look in the direction of the seawall and the 50 yards or so if riverbed beyond it, where an old Spaniard's house stood.
It was in his service as a coconut plantation overseer that grandfather had spent the last 30 years of his life. Grandmother had been widowed 3 years now. I often wondered whether I was being depended upon to spend the years ahead in the service of this great house. One day, I learned that Ida, a classmate in high school, was the old Spaniard's niece. All my doubts disappeared. It was as if, before his death, grandfather had spoken to me about her, concealing the seriousness of the matter by putting it over as a joke. If now I kept true to the virtues, she would step out of her bedroom, ostensibly to say good morning to her uncle. Her real purpose, I knew, was to reveal thus her assent to my desire. On quiet mornings, I imagined the patter of her shoes upon the wooden veranda floor as a further sign, and I would hurry off to school, taking the route she had fixed for me past to 7-Eleven, the town plaza, and the church. The health center is of the plaza, and at the last school grounds. I asked myself whether I would try to walk with her and decided it would be the height of rudeness, enough that in her white skirt and white midi she would be half a block ahead and, from that distance, perhaps throw a glance in my direction, to bestow upon my heart a deserved and abundant blessing. I believe it was but right that, in some such way as this, her mission in my life was disguised. With every victory at singles, at the handball court, the game was then the craze at school. I could feel my body glow in the sun as though it had been instantly been cast in bronze. I guarded my mind and did not let my wits go astray. In class, I would not allow a lesson to pass unmastered. Our English teacher could not put no question before us that did not have a ready answer in my head. It was perhaps on my violin that her name wrought such a tender spell. Maestro Antonino remarked the dexterity of my stubby fingers. Quickly, I raced through a lard until I had all but committed 2/3 of the book to memory. During the Thanksgiving Day program, he made me render a number, complete with pizzicati and harmonics.
Our very own Albert Spaldico.
Ida, I thought, would be in the audience. I looked around quickly but could not see her. I thought of money I would earn. For several days now I had but one wish, to buy a paper. At night, when the house was quiet, I would fill the table with words that would tell Ida how much I adored her. What people now observe at home was the diligence which I attended to my violin lessons. My aunt, who had come from the farm to join her children for holidays, brought with her a maidservant, and to the poor girl was given the chore of taking the money to the bakers for rolls and pandesal. I realized at once that it would be no longer becoming on my part to make these morning trips to the bakers. I could not thank my aunt enough.
Hey Albert, where do you want to be a musician for party?
But the remark hurt me. Although grandmother had counseled me kindly to mind my work at school, I went again and again to music room for rehearsals. She had demanded that I deposit with her my earnings. I had felt too weak to refuse. Secretly, I counted the money and decided not to ask for it until I had enough with which to buy a necklace. Why this time I wanted to give Ida a necklace, I didn't know, but I had set my heart on it. I searched the downtown shops. The Chinese clerks, seeing me so young, were annoyed when I inquired about prices.
But an acerto the next Sunday with the Buena Vista Women's Club wished to give Don Esteban's daughter, Josefina and Alicia, who were arriving on the morning steamer from Manila. The spinsters were much loved by the ladies. Years ago, when they were younger, these ladies studied solfeggio with Josefina and the piano and harp with Alicia. This party will be a complete surprise. They've hired our band.
As I give my gift, it seemed to me rather apt that such gifts went to her. Already several girls were gathered around Ida.
Will you be away during the vacation?
No, I will be staying.
So you know all about this?
At 7 on the appointed evening, our small band gathered quietly at the stage, and when the ladies arrived in their dress, twittering with excitement, we were commanded to play the poet and peasant overture.
Patay las buhay ko, limutin ang pag-ibig mo. Di na babalik, hindi na babalik. Pilitin mang ayusin to.
By midnight, the merrymaking lulled. Pizza is signaled to us to put our instruments away. We walk in a single file across the hall, led by one of the servants.
Have you eaten? If you wait a little while till they're gone, I'm gonna prepare a package for you.
Because he was embarrassed, the boy walked out the door and left with Pete.
He walked with me part of the way home. We stopped at the baker's when I told him that I wanted to buy with my own money some bread to eat on the way to grandmother's house at the edge of the sewer. He laughed, thinking it strange that I should be hungry. We found ourselves alone at the counter, and we watched the bakery assistants at work until our bodies grew warm from the oven across the door. It was not quite 5. And the bread was not yet ready.